Vitreous just arrived.
Yeah.
Right on time.
Only the diehards.
Microphone. Yeah.
Mic is on. I think it's all good, no?
I don't know. Please unmute.
That's good.
Good like this? Okay, so welcome back to the second series of lecture. This morning I will focus on, let's say, spectral stability, and then how, in some sense, you justify modulation equation with respect to spectral stability. I will then show you how you deduce, say, nonlinear stability from spectral stability, and various ways to justify modulational equations in the end. And finally, if I have time, I will talk a little bit about spectral stability, how you prove actually spectral stability in some particular cases. And if you are not able to prove analytically, you do it by numerics. And I will show you some numerical results. So, let's start with spectral stability. So, as a reminder, let me do the job for KdVKS. So, for KdVKS, the linearized Let me remind the linearized KdV Ks equations. So, it's okay. So, in the frame of the periodic wave, the linearized equations are written like this. Okay, so I call U bar the periodic wave. With wave speed C. And let's say period one. Okay, you can always change the wavelength. Okay, to get the period equal to 1. Okay, plus, so the third derivative of u plus delta, so there is an epsilon here, and the second derivative of u plus the fourth derivative of u equals 0. And let's say I will show you how people used to present spectral stability, let's say 10 years ago, and at least in this framework. So as I said last time, the spectral problem associated to that is nothing but this equation where you Laplace transform in time. So the spectral problem reads lambda u plus u minus c u prime so it's an ODE problem now. Okay. And to see the structure of the, let's say, the eigenvectors, I transform this equation into a system. So I, let's say, introduce capital phi is u, u prime prime, and the third derivative of u. And this equation now reads c prime equal a of x lambda and phi with a one periodic. Okay? So I will continue here. Okay, and if you apply Floquet theory, the resultant matrix is written as P of x and lambda times some exponential of R lambda times x. And it is invertible, of course, and one periodic. Okay? So basically, you will search for solution of this problem that satisfies C of phi, sorry, of x plus 1 is exponential I times C times phi. Okay? To get bounded solution. Okay? I remind you that I C is called the Floquet number, let's say XE, multiplier. Okay? And if you want bounded solution, the only possible choice is that the Floquet multiplier is purely imaginary. Okay? So then you have to search for solution of this problem satisfying these boundary conditions. Okay, and it is easily seen that you can transform this problem into finding solution among periodic solutions. So how you do that? You just consider tilde phi is exponential minus e xi x times phi of x. Okay, and doing so, you see easily that psi prime, psi phi of x plus 1 is phi tilde of x. Okay, so you come back with periodic solution. Okay, and now if you are looking for the differential equation satisfied by phi tilde, so you will find something like, maybe I will. You find something like this, okay? basically, this is the way you solve the problem numerically. Okay. So, actually, I am interested in the L2 spectrum of this problem. So the question is it possible to decompose a L2 solution, a L2 function, into one periodic function like this? Okay? Or another way to say that, can I decompose a L2 function that satisfies this this relation? Okay? If I am able to do that, then this analysis ensures me that I get all the L2 spectrum. Okay? So how do you do that? So represent representation of L2 of our function with periodic functions. So actually what I will do is just to write a function as the inverse of its Fourier transform. Okay, so U of X, let's say U is okay, to do all the computation, I will consider U is in the Schwarz class, okay, so that I don't care about permitting integration, summation, etc., etc. So, but another way to say that is that I will perform some formal computation, but they can be justified. Okay. So U of X is the integral of R of the exponential of I x xi times the Fourier transform of U. Okay. Okay, and what I will do actually is that I will group all the, let's say, frequency that are congruent modulo 2 pi. Okay, so that I will be able to build up some one periodic functions. So, this is a summation for k in z for the integral from 2k minus 1 pi to 2k plus 1 pi of the exponential of I x xi times the Fourier transform of U about xi. Okay, and I just make a change of variable. So this is the integral from minus pi to pi, and the sum for k in z of the exponential of I x xi plus 2k pi u of xi plus 2k pi. Okay? So, yeah.
The U is one periodic, right?
No, U is a L2 function.
Okay, but the U defined by a phi.
Oh, sorry, okay. Let's say I take U is not the U.
Okay,
so let me write J everywhere. Okay, it's a L2 function.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, and the question is, I found out some, let's say, candidates to be eigenvectors. can I represent any L2 function as a superposition of these candidates? Okay, just this is actually what is done when you perform the spectral stability of a differential operator with constant coefficient, and you use Fourier transform. Okay, so you know by Fourier transform that you have all the eigenvectors possible. So I try to do the same, but with a differential operator with periodic coefficients. So I found some candidates, and I try to represent J as a superposition of a periodic one periodic function. So I factor out this exponential, and I get g of x is the integral from minus pi to pi of the exponential of x I x xi, and the sum from k z of the exponential of I to k pi x hat j of xi plus 2k pi. And I give a name to this, let's say check of x and xi. Okay, and you see that it is a one periodic function. For any xi, this guy is a periodic function, is a one periodic function. Okay, it's a Fourier series. Okay, so you get g, hat g of x plus 1 xi is check of x xi. Okay, so I can represent any L2 function as a superposition of one periodic function parametrized by xi, and xi is what is called the block number. And it is between minus pi and pi, or 0 to pi, it's up to you. And this guy is called the block transform of G. Okay? And so maybe I will switch to slides now. I don't remember if it's the one. It's the two. Okay. So I will switch to slides now. And so you have the block transform, as I introduced you. And let me give you some properties. So as I said, it is a one periodic function in space. Okay. If I if I change the block number by 2 pi, I get exponential minus 2i pi x of the block transform. How does it work with respect to the derivation? So the block transform of the derivative of the function is the classical derivative plus ixi. Okay? This is exactly what I've written when I wrote down the spectral problem. Okay? And what is interesting for this block transform is that if you assume that A, capital A, is a one periodic function, the block transform of A times u is a of x times the block transform. So in some sense, you diagonalize the periodic differential operator. Okay? So actually, the analysis, when you perform the spectral analysis of differential operator with periodic coefficient, okay, it's just carrying a block transform. Okay, just the same you would do for differential operator with constant coefficient, you would use Fourier, but with periodic coefficient, you use block transform. Okay? And all you have to know is that the derivative is transformed into the derivative plus I xi. Okay? And what you did on this way is that you transform finding, let's say, continuous spectrum of a differential operator in L2 into finding point spectrum of a differential operator among periodic functions. Okay, so this is completely classical spectral theory. And from this, you deduce the structure of the spectrum. So the structure of the spectrum is written here. It's the union of all the spectrum of operator L xi. So L xi is just the differential operator when you apply the block transform. Okay, so it's a differential operator parameterized by xi. And you search for the spectrum of that. And since you apply the block transform, now the eigenvectors are nothing but periodic functions. Okay? And so you get a collection. If the differential operator have a nice property, and this is the case here, you get point spectrum, an infinity of curves. Okay? So the spectrum has this structure. Okay? So a collection of curves. And two comments. So the first comment is that you have invariance by translation. Okay? So it is quite standard this type of theory that zero is an eigenvalue associated to the derivative. Okay? And this is an eigenvalue associated to the derivative for the zero Floquet number. Okay? And zero Floquet number means coperiodic solution. Okay? And more, so you know that you have continuous. You have family of continuous spectrum, and you know that zero is a part of this family. Okay, so you know there is in your in the complex plane where you are looking for eigenvalues, you know that zero is a part of a curve. Okay, so you're sure that there will be a curve that will go through 0, 0, near the origin. Okay? So the best you will have for spectral stability is just marginal stability. Okay? So this is the first comment. The second comment is that you have, for KDVKS, you have invariance by Galilean invariance. And from this, you deduce that one, the solution constant equal to one, okay, this is an eigenvector, it is bounded, is equal to u prime. So you know that zero has algebraic. Multiplicity equal to 2. Okay? Geometric multiplicity equal to 1, and algebraic multiplicity equals to 2. Okay? So actually, it's you have a Jordan block for psi equal 0, and what you expect is that you will have two curves, okay? So what is expected? Two curves of eigenvalue bifurcating from the origin. Okay. The second remark concerns reaction diffusion. The reaction diffusion. Yes. Yeah, yeah. The picture does not mean anything. Okay, so just to tell that there are two, but I will come back to the position of the curve just okay. After that.
Another remark is if you have a drop block, you may have polynomial instability, right? You may have, if you take the exponential of the drop block, you may have something that goes like t.
Yeah. It will be stable because it bifurcates and it will give you actually it split. Okay, so it's not just being on zero; it's splitting.
Okay. Okay, I understand.
Okay, so for reaction diffusion setting, actually, zero is a. Is the only eigenvalue, as there's no Jordan block. So actually, the perturbation theory is very simple. Okay, you have a simple eigenvalue, which perturbs analytically, and you have just one curve that bifurcates from zero. But in the conservation law setting, it could be one, two, or more. Okay. So a bit of some references. So as I said, the structure of periodic waves is richer for conservation laws than for reaction diffusion. Reaction diffusion, actually, you just have one parameter that encodes the periodic wave. This is the wavelength. And for conservation law, you have the wavelength plus all conserved quantities. Okay. So in my in KDV case setting. The constant, the conserved quantity is the average, the mean, the spatial mean of the solution. Okay, so you have two parameters, as I said, the spatial mean and the periodic wavelength. Okay, but if you consider other conservation law with more conservations, then you can have more parameters. Okay. So phase dynamic was a terminology for reaction diffusion because there was only one parameter, k, and we replaced by modulation. And the connection between spectral stability and modulation was established in various cases. So for viscous conservation law, it was done by Denis Serre in 2005. For the general case of conservation law. And you have some partial computation before that for KS by Frisch and Shea and Tual, and for Euler-Cordeweg by Gavriluk. And since about 10 years, there were many connections made. So for NLS, it was done by Schneider and Juhl. For generalized KDV, it was done by Zumbrunn and Johnson. And for Saint-Venant and KDVKS by myself and Rodriguez. The very first example, I did not mention that, the very first example was done by Whittam for the Cordeweg de Vries equation. Okay, concerning the, so this was the connection between spectral stability and modulation equation. If you are only considering the spectral stability, of KDVKS. So for KDV, since the equation is integrable, you're able more or less to do explicit computation and to show that the spectrum lies completely on the imaginary axis. Okay? And this is the best you obtain for KDVKS. Okay, it's a reversible system. If you have some spectrum that is in the stable subspace, you will have also a spectrum is an unstable half space. So it is either marginally stable or unstable. OK? Okay, the situation is completely different for viscous. In the viscous case, okay, it is not reversible anymore, and you can have a stable spectrum and no unstable spectrum. So for KdV, it was done completely explicitly in 2009, and for the KdV-Ks, there are some numerics by Barn-Lepomniachtchi and by Ercolani. That is more or less basically on the fact that they knew the spectrum for KdV. Okay, so you know the spectrum for KdV and you perturb it. So for some reason, they used in 98 the fact that they knew the spectrum for KdV, but in the paper they do not explicit it. So they say we perturb the KdV spectrum about periodic wave, but there are no explicit computation, or they are telling that it is in some paper, in a Russian paper. So you have nothing explicit, so it was done explicitly in 2009. Okay, and the goal of what I will present now is to show how you use a modulation equation to write down a set of proper spectral assumptions. Okay, so the first assumption is a geometric assumption. And more or less, if you remember how I build up the modulation theory, at some stage, I had to solve inverse a linear operator. Okay? And to inverse this linear operator, which admit a kernel, I have to write down some compatibility condition. Okay? So the first assumption is a geometric assumption on the profile. Okay? And this amounts to tell you that all the formal computation you do to derive modulation equation is indeed correct. Okay, that there are no more compatibility conditions than the one you used to write down the modulation equation. Okay. So once you make this geometric assumption that zero is a non-semi-simple eigenvalue of multiplicity equals to two, you are able to prove that near zero, the spectrum is written like this. Lambda j of xi is I times lambda j naught xi plus something that is negligible. Okay, so the Jordan block split in two eigenvalues. Okay, and they expand like this. Okay, so if you want. So you know that the spectrum around zero expands like this. Okay, so it's at first order it comes in straight line. Okay, so if you want stability, you want that the straight line to be a line along the imaginary axis. If the straight line goes like this, okay, necessarily you get spectral instability. Okay, so this gives you a necessary condition: is lambda g naught should be real. Okay, so I call this hyperbolicity assumption. Okay, so assume that lambda g naught is real, you know that the spectrum, the curves of the spectrum are tangent to the imaginary axis. Okay? So, to prove some stability, you will add an additional assumption in that the curves, more or less, behave like this. Okay, maybe I will make a bigger picture. So order one, the curves are like this, okay? And if I consider the real part, I want the real part behave like a parabola. So I want that the spectrum, let's say, is lies in this region, okay? To have some dissipation. And the main purpose of the next two slides is to reinterpret those spectral assumptions, which are more or less the minimal you may want to prove stability, is to reinterpret this on a Wittam system. Okay, so the theorem, more or less, is written like this. So, first, you assume that the eigenvalue of the real problem bifurcate like this, okay? And actually, what you are able to prove is that lambda g naught are the characteristic speed of the Wittam system linearized about constant state k bar m bar. Okay? So assuming that lambda g naught is a real number, are real numbers, is nothing but assuming that the Wittam's modulation system is hyperbolic. Okay? And hyperbolic meaning that you linearize about a constant state and you check the eigenvalue. Okay? And what we will do in the following is that we will assume something a little bit stronger, is that the Wittam's modulation equation are strictly hyperbolic, meaning that lambda 1 and lambda 2 are different. Okay? And doing such an assumption implies that the eigenvalue are analytic now in psi. Okay, you have expansion with respect to psi and not square root of psi or something weird. Okay. So this result was found in many situations for viscous conservation law by Serre and for generalized KdV equation by Johnson. Okay. And what we did more with my colleague Miguel Rodriguez is to go one step further, both in the modulation theory and in the spectral stability theory. It's just considering second-order partial differential equations. Okay, so the, let's say the viscous or parabolic, but this does not mean that L1 and L2 have a positive eigenvalue, but let's say second-order Wittam's modulation equation. And actually, if you perform the same type of analysis, you linearize the equation, this set of modulation equation, about k bar m bar, and you expand eigenvalue about zero, you will find the same expansion than for the real problem. Okay, so both spectrum are equal up to order three. Okay, this makes sense because it's a second order partial differential equation. If I want something more accurate, I need higher order corrections. Okay, so the assumption five, telling that the spectrum the real part is smaller than some constant time c square, is nothing but dissipativity of the viscous modulation system. Okay. So now, if I want to summarize the set of spectral assumptions, what does it mean to be, let's say, diffusively spectrally stable in that setting? First, the Poincaré return map is full rank. Okay, so for KdVKS, this is nothing but telling that zero is of multiplicity equal to two. Of course, D1 is, let's say, classical one. You want that the spectrum lies in the stable Hall space. okay? Except for xi equals 0, for xi equals 0, you know that 0 is an eigenvalue. But you want that the remainder of the spectrum lies in the stable half space. Okay? D2 is a dissipativity assumption. D3, 0 is an eigenvalue of multiplicity 2. And D4, so you assume that the characteristic velocity are different. So the Wooten's modulation system is strictly hyperbolic. Okay? So in the reaction diffusion setting, you can remove D3, okay? 0 is a simple eigenvalue. You have not D4 as well. Okay, and what I will show now is first how do you prove nonlinear stability from spectral stability, and then how do you validate rigorously a modulation equation at the nonlinear level? What I did up to now is to validate Wooten's modulation equation at the spectral level, but how do I do the same job at the nonlinear level, at the PDA level? Okay, and finally, I will consider the problem of proving actually spectral stability. So, spectral stability is not just verifying condition two, it's verifying the full set of assumptions. Not necessarily, because you can have an interaction between first order and second order, and even if you have dissipativity, it may happen that it could be spectrally unstable. Depends. You have to carry out the computation to make sure of that. Okay, so to rigorously prove stability, I need to introduce some definition. So I explained this last time, but let me remind you how it works. When you have unimodal solution, the good notion, the correct notion, good notion of stability is orbital stability, that in the sense that consider you perturb a solitary wave. Okay, assume that the solitary wave travel with speed c equals 0. Okay, I made the change of variable, and the solitary wave is a stationary solution. Okay, and I do a perturbation. What is expected is that when t goes to infinity, you will not converge to the actual solution, but to translation. So what you will do actually is to compare the real solution to all the possible translation of the reference solution. So this gives you a distance, okay, between u and v. So u up to all translation minus v. Okay? So this is more or less the distance you will consider to prove orbital stability. So it is perfectly suitable for unimodal wave, but of course for periodic wave, it is not sufficient. Okay? So for periodic wave, you need to allow some resynchronization. Okay? As I said, what is expected? So if you have a periodic wave like this, when t goes to infinity, what numerics shows is that, so this is a reference solution, and let's say this is what you get. when t goes to infinity, okay? In some sense, what you need to compare is the solution up to some transformation that make this point go there, this point go there, this point go there, etc., etc. So you need some resynchronization. And how you do that? You use a phi, let's say some diffeomorphism, okay? Some perturbation of identity. Okay? So this is what is written here. And we add a sort of penalization in that we want that the derivative of phi minus identity is small. Okay? So what does it mean? And not phi minus identity. Okay? The derivative of phi minus identity. So what it will tell you on the stability, on the final result, is that, okay, I draw you a picture of a periodic wave. And since the derivative of phi minus identity will be small, you have some localization, and you will know that more or less phi at plus infinity and minus infinity will have a limit. So what you will get is that more or less here you will have something like phi infinity. Okay, here phi minus infinity. And between some phi bounded, okay? But the fact is that asymptotically, you are quite close to, you don't change the wave number, okay? So if you consider the wave number, at minus infinity is the wave number of the reference periodic solution.
So you could match those, have it infinity, you could match them by translation?
Yeah, more or less. But it's not, you cannot translate.
Thing, yeah.
You can do here, it here, it here, but these are not the same. So it's a transformation, but the fact that if you consider, let's say, the period, asymptotically, the period are the same. So what we are not able to do is that situation. So that situation would be, let's say, one wave number here and one wave number here. Okay? So in this, we are not able to change the period. We change the phase, but we do not change the period. Okay? And actually, if you look at the modulation level, having K1 different from K2 is a shock for the modulation equation. Okay, you have two different parameters, so it is a shock. Okay, and the only situation where you are able to deal with such situation is the reaction diffusion setting. So that's okay for reaction diffusion equations. And this is in the memoir of the AMS. By Dulman, Sandsted, Schneider, and now I have the third S is Scheele. Okay? So they are able to deal with the situation where with K1 and K2 are different, but close. Okay, so small shocks. Okay, and actually we are able to deal not only with localized perturbation of periodic wave, but we are able to deal with perturbations that look like that. Okay? I can take an initial condition that is slightly changed, like this. Okay? And then let it go, and I can have a non-localized perturbation. Okay? When I change a little bit the phase here and the phase here, asymptotically, it's not a localized perturbation anymore. Okay? This is completely different to the case where I just plug something here in the middle. Okay, you see that here and here, the phase is not changed at all. So these are localized perturbations, but you can consider non-localized perturbation, but in that sense. Okay. When you perturb like this with K1 different from KRF, and the same here, we are not able to deal with this. Okay, it's a very hard problem. Okay, so let's say the general theorem for parabolic systems reads like this. So a diffusively spectrally stable periodic wave, in the sense I showed you, is asymptotically stable in that sense. Okay, so you take initial perturbation in L1 and HK, and the distance HK, so the distance I wrote here, so you substitute H by the functional space I introduced before. So the distance goes to zero when T goes to infinity. Okay? And obviously, the phase does not decrease to zero. Okay? The derivative of the phase and the perturbation decrease to zero, but the phase and the distance between the perturbation and the actual solution does not decrease to zero. Okay? But they remain small. Okay? So it's really reminiscent to orbital stability. Okay? If I take imagine for a solitary wave, you take a perturbation. So as I said, the reference solution will lie here. Okay, so you have a small shift. So the L infinity norm will not decrease to zero, but still it will remain small. Okay, and it will depend on the initial condition. So this is the same type of result you get here. Okay, you need some resynchronization to get asymptotic stability, but if you look at the original coordinates, you get that the L infinity norm is small and bounded, but does not decrease to zero. Okay, so some references. So in the case D equals zero, as I said, is the reaction diffusion setting. It was done years ago by Schneider for Ginzburg-Landau, by Sandsted, Schill, Schneider, and Wecker in 2012, and by Johnson, myself, Rodriguez, and Zumbun in 2013. So this is, let's say, the easy case. And when D denotes the number of conservation law. So when D is larger than one for shallow water equation in KdV case, we did this in 2012 and 2013. And actually, it was done years ago by Kevin Zumbrun, but in a multidimensional setting. So what is different from multi-D to 1D? So actually, all the proofs are based more or less by a semi-group theory. Okay, and actually, in dimension 2 and 3, etc., the decrease of the semi-group is sufficient to deal with the non-linearity. Okay, it's not true anymore in 1D. Okay. So some elements of proof. Just to give you the philosophy of the computation. So how do you work? First, you take your real solution, and you perform, in some sense, the change of variable identity minus phi. Okay? And in that setting, you decompose the resynchronized real solution into the actual periodic wave plus a perturbation. Okay? You could have imagined to write things like this. Actually, the more natural way to decompose a solution would be to write u of xt is u bar of x plus phi of xt plus a perturbation. Okay? But if you write things like that and you perturb, you try to separate linear term from nonlinear term, the nonlinear term will contain phi. Okay? And phi does not decrease in time. Okay? If you do like this, the nonlinear term won't contain any phi term anymore, but phi x, phi t, etc., etc., that decrease in time. Okay? So you get better decrease property by performing first the change of variable and then decompose the solution. Okay, so the equation for the perturbation reads like this. So dt minus the linear operator about a periodic wave of the perturbation v plus the perturbation along ux. Okay, you group them together. And you have a nonlinear term. Okay, and then it's just a DML formula. So V, the perturbation, plus the perturbation along ux, or phi t, is given by this. Okay? And, I'm sorry, S of t is the semigroup exponential tl that has a representation in through the Bloch transform. Okay? Imagine if L was a differential operator with constant coefficient, this is nothing but the representation of the semigroup in Fourier coefficient. Okay, but no, it's just with Floquet coefficient. Okay, and writing things like this makes the estimates on semigroup very easy. You know that when you do the estimates with Fourier, it's much more easy than in original coordinates. When you, for example, for the heat equation, it's much more easier to do everything in Fourier than in original coordinate. And that's the same spirit here. You write everything in block instead of original coordinate. And once you have written this fixed point argument, you separate between the critical dynamic along ux, okay? And you know that the dynamics along ux phi will not decrease in time, it will remain bounded, but that's it. And let's say what is orthogonal to ux, okay, the non-critical evolution will decrease exponentially in time. Okay, so you have a critical evolution, okay, with algebraic decay, and a non-critical part. Okay, and what I did here, so I separate critical and non-critical, and I added one more argument, and this argument is more or less to take care about an initial phi naught, okay? An initial perturbation like this, okay? If I consider only localized perturbation, phi naught is equal to zero, okay? And I don't need this, so psi is a cutoff, okay? It's just to make an interpolation between the initial condition and what's going on as t goes to infinity. So psi of t is equal to zero when t is larger than one. Okay, it's just to take care about the initial condition. So for, you will see in the literature, in some paper, where people are dealing only with localized perturbation, you don't have this trick. Okay, phi naught is equal to zero, you don't care. Okay, you just care about what's going on when phi when t goes to infinity for phi. So you have an equation for phi and an equation for v, okay, that are separated. And now you are able, so it's an equation for phi, but the nonlinear term here contains v, quadratic term means v, phi x and phi t, okay, and some of their derivative. Okay, so you have something written as a fixed endpoint if you derive the first equation with respect to t and x. Okay, you derive the number of time you need to get something that is appears as a fixed point for v, phi x and phi t. Okay, and then the proof is very much similar to what you do for interaction diffusion setting, or what you do even for ODEs. Okay, for ODEs, you write things as a fixed point with a DML formula, and you try to control the nonlinear term. Okay, so the things you have to do first is to deduce from spectral stability linear stability, so estimates on the semigroup. Okay. So for ODEs, it's just telling that you have an exponential decrease. But in this PDE setting, you will have algebraic decrease, you know, because the spectrum is tangent to the imaginary axis. Okay. So you have a decreasing rate that are that look similar to the heat equation. Okay. So algebraic decrease. And to control the higher order norms, basically what you do is to use energy estimates, okay? Just something which is quite basic with viscous conservation law, okay? You do estimates, and you estimate as many derivatives as you need, and you show that you control this higher derivative only with the L2 norm. And what you get in the end is that you have a typical decreasing rate of t to the minus 1/4, okay? And whereas the L-infinity norms are small, but do not decrease in time, okay? So the conclusion of this is that I know at this stage, just to prove modulational stability, nonlinear stability, I do not need modulational equation. I just needed a resynchronization, okay? So I just needed, in some sense, to change phi, okay? The phi and I introduced in modulation equation, okay? I do not need to modulate, let's say, the spatial mean, okay? To get this rate of decrease, okay? Shall I make a break, a 5-minute break, or shall I go on?
Okay.
I can go on and we finish earlier.
Yeah.
Okay. So, as I said, you use resynchronization, you get this decrease. And to finish my talk, I will consider two questions. First question, the justification of modulation equation. What does it mean, in particular in that setting? And the other question is the spectral stability. So concerning modulation equation, actually you have a first set of results. The first set of results, which has nothing to do with asymptotic stability, it's just you try to, you made some expansion and you want to validate this, okay? So the first set of equations you get, these are first order modulation equation, and if things go right, they are hyperbolic or strictly hyperbolic, okay? And I showed you how you can continue the expansion to any order to build up a solution of the actual system to any order. Okay, so the first set of results that justify modulation equation are those one. Okay, you take a solution of the modulation equation and you build up a solution of the real problem here KDVKS, on the relevant time scale. And for modulation equation, you took hyperbolic time scale. So you will be able to build up solution of the original system on asymptotically large time interval of order 1 over epsilon, where epsilon is a modulation parameter. Okay? And T star is nothing but telling that this is the moment that ensures that you have no breaking in the modulation equation. Okay? You have no shocks. Okay, so this was done exactly in that setting for reaction diffusion in the memoir of the AMS, for NLS by Dool and Schneider. And one remark is that you can, let's say, classify this type of result in what is called nonlinear or linear geometrical optics. And you have many, many papers in this spirit by, let's say, Roche, Joly, Métivier. There are plenty of them, either for a semi-linear hyperbolic equation, for the wave equation, this is a very historical example of linear geometric optics. Okay, and you have many papers also by Karl, by Lan, and a huge community dealing with NLS. Okay, and if you go one step further, and if you use, let's say, second-order modulation equations, dissipative equation, what you could expect is that you gain one order in the size of the time interval, and you're able to build up solutions that are valid up to interval of size 1 over epsilon square. Okay? And now what you expect is that T is arbitrary, because you are dealing with parabolic system, okay? So this is the first step of the first set of typical results you may want to deal with, okay? But actually, many people did that, okay? And many very strong people did that. So we did not that. We did something different, and we tried to see to which extent modulation equation helps to describe the long time behavior of perturbation of periodic waves. Okay, so exactly the question I addressed before. And okay, this is a very vague statement of the theorem. So instead of so in my theorem, instead of considering a periodic wave about k bar m bar, just modulate the periodic solution with some parameter tilde k m and tilde m that are solution of the viscous conservation law modulation equation. Okay, so do that. Then what you get in the description of the asymptotic behavior, so you get a better representation, okay? If you remember, if I fix k bar m bar, the decrease here is t to the minus to the power minus 1 over 4, okay? So I have again in the description a refined description of the asymptotic behavior by allowing modulations, okay? So in that sense, it justifies the use of modulation equation, not only to describe transition, the very first step of the evolution, but also asymptotic behavior of the solution.
So the tilde of the solutions of the
modulation. Yeah, of the viscous one.
So does that constant have an epsilon in it?
There are no, actually, you have no epsilon anymore. Okay, you get rid of it. It's a matter of
rescaling.
Yeah, okay. It's a matter of rescaling. Okay, and actually, to be a little bit more precise, What you do is that these are the asymptote. You take the solution, you put epsilon equals to 1, and you consider the asymptotic behavior of the solution of the viscous problem. Okay, and what you see that actually you have two characteristic wave plus dissipation. So the asymptotic behavior is two wave propagating with a two characteristic velocity plus some dissipation. Okay, and for that actually you can build up a new set of parabolic equations that describe exactly this tau evolution. Okay, you will in some sense you will diagonalize the modulation system. Okay, so to be let's say a little bit more honest or a little bit more precise, is the diagonalized version of the modulation equation that is used here. Okay, but actually they are completely equivalent as t goes to infinity. Okay, of course when t equals zero they are not the same, but asymptotically the Wittem's modulation system up to order 2 is a superposition of two, let's say, parabolic equations. So this is in this sense that you use modulation equations. Okay, they are large-scale counterparts. Okay, and to end up my... So I'm done with the, let's say, the justification of modulation equation, and I finished my talk with some question about the spectral stability. So, as I said, you have four or five hypotheses to fulfill to meet the spectral assumption. Okay. And actually, you are not able to prove actually the spectral stability, so you have to carry on numeric. Okay, in most cases, you have no explicit formula except, for example, Gibbs-Borlando or whatever. In very particular case, you are able to do some analysis, but in the general case, you have to do numerics. So this is what is shown here for KDVKS, and you see the evolution of the spectrum when you increase the period. Okay, so at the beginning, the Wittem's modulation system is not hyperbolic. Okay, and so the spectrum crosses the imaginary axis transversally, and you have strong instability. Okay, and as you increase the wavelength, you get stability. This is what you see on the fourth picture. So you get stability here, stability here, and the final stage F, you have a loss of dissipativity. Okay, the curves are tangent, but they are not on the correct part of the Hals plane. Okay, so this is one step further, and actually this one I think it's a zoom of the first pictures. Okay,
so what's varying is the period of traveling wave.
Yeah, the period of the traveling wave. And actually, for KDVKS, this is very particular because of the Galilean invariance. Changing the spatial mean means changing the wave speed. Okay. So actually, you can fix, let's say, the spatial mean to zero. Okay, and factor out this additional parameter, and only consider what's going on with respect to the period. Once you have the conclusion for the period, you can draw the conclusion for any periodic traveling wave, because you go from one to another simply by changing the spatial mean. Okay, and changing the spatial mean is changing the speed. Okay, so this does not change anything in the stability problem. Okay, so the conclusion is that you get a range of stability. So this is basically what I said in my first talks, like wave ending. You know that small amplitude solution should be unstable. Solution with large period that are close to solitary wave should be unstable as well. Here you get, and between, you have a range of stable solution. So epsilon, if you remember my notation for KdVKS, represents the weight of dispersion. So the equation, if you remember, is ut plus uxx plus epsilon ux plus delta uxx plus uxxxx equals zero. Okay? And we took the fact that epsilon squared plus delta squared is equal to one. Okay? You can always do some algebraic manipulation to get to say that if you consider all these cases, you deal with everything. So epsilon goes to one, okay, means delta goes to zero. This is the case where KdV is dominant, okay? And when epsilon goes to zero, delta goes to one, so this is a KS equation. Okay, and as you see, for KS, you have a very small region of stability, of periodic wave. And for a long time, people assumed that there was no stable periodic wave for KS. So it's untrue. Okay, but actually, the family of stable is so small that it's obvious that you won't be able to capture them if you are not very careful, okay? Okay, and then you have some bifurcation in the diagram that are quite hard to describe. And what you see that when epsilon goes to one in the KdV regime, you have an asymptotic region of stability, okay? You have a finite region with given values, okay? And actually, this is a place where you can prove analytically spectral stability, okay? So there are no approximations at this stage. When epsilon goes to zero, you can prove a theorem, okay? Okay, for roll waves in shallow water equation, as I said, if you consider small amplitude solution of shallow water equation, you get KdV chaos. Okay, and you have a bunch of results that draw conclusion for the asymptotic regime for the full system. And this is what we did, basically. We have many information for KdV chaos, and we draw some conclusion for shallow water. So near the instability ratio, we have the same type of theorem than KdV chaos. Okay? So this means that when you know that when F is bigger than 2, constant state are unstable. Okay? And if you consider F minus 2 much smaller than 1, actually this is more or less KdV chaos. And again, you have a proof of stability, or spectral stability, an analytical proof of stability of periodic wave. But the problem is that this wave have an asymptotically large period. Okay, so as F goes to 2, the solutions that are spectrally stable have a wavelength, a typical wavelength of 1 over F minus 2. So you do not observe them. Okay, you have a nice theorem, but it's useless. Okay, so And then we did some numerics for a bigger f, okay, and you find then some finite value for stability. Another way to perform exact computation is in the vanishing viscosity limit, so when the viscosity goes to zero. So when the viscosity goes to zero, what you are able to prove is that the periodic wave looks like this. Okay, so these are periodic waves. They actually they converge to periodic waves that are discontinuous. Okay, so as you see, when delta goes to zero, you get a hyperbolic system. You may have shocks. Okay, and so you have periodic waves. They are necessarily discontinuous. Okay, you have no continuous periodic wave of the Heaviskite system. And when delta goes to zero, you get this type of solution. So, of course, when delta is small, you have a regularized version of that. Okay? So, the game will be to let's say, perform some explicit computation in the Heaviskite limit, okay, when delta goes to zero, and to try to show analytically that the conclusion you draw for delta equals zero remain true for delta bigger than zero but small. Okay? And since the higher order derivative is in front of delta, all the tools that you will use is a geometric singular perturbation theory. So it's not easy at all. Okay, so for discontinuous traveling wave, you have a theory that dates back to Dressler in the 50s. Okay, and actually you have the equation of profile is given by a first order ODE. Okay, and you can integrate it explicitly. And so you get an explicit description of the profile. Okay? So of course you have, as I said, you have continuous counterpart to this when delta goes to zero, and the proof uses geometric singular perturbation argument by this was done by Herterich. The proof by Herterich, okay, tells you that when delta goes to zero, in some sense, you converge to this discontinuous periodic wave. But there is one big hole in the middle of this theory, is that you don't have any explicit expansion. You don't have asymptotic expansion. And if you want to carry out spectral analysis, you need this expansion. Okay, so you need to be precise in the shock. You need to give exactly how this perturbs in this zone. Okay. And actually, there is a very hard point to tackle, is the fact that in the continuous part, actually, you have a solid point. Okay, and if you go back to the theory, the ODE theory, having a solid point, so this means that the derivative here vanishes at some point h. Okay, this means that let's say you lose the normal hyperbolicity of the slow system. So the slow system is when epsilon equals zero, okay? And if you look the normal the derivative normal to this slow manifold, it is attractive in one sense, and past the sonic point, it is repulsive. Okay? So we have what we called a canard. It's called the canard in non-standard analysis, okay? And it's nothing but a loss of normal hyperbolicity. So it is very hard to, you have no, let's say, standard singular geometrical perturbation theory, you have to do more, okay? So this is work in progress, but anyway, you can still track what's going on both numerically for continuous and discontinuous wave, and analytically for discontinuous wave. So we are able to prove numerically, okay, and it's not it's just verifying the assumption, okay. So this is a Froude number, and actually when the Froude number is bigger than 30, 32, there are no stable periodic wave anymore. So you find a stable periodic wave in this region. Okay, so this is a zoom of what's going on when f goes to 2. Actually, you see that the zone when you find a stable periodic wave goes to infinity like this. Okay, this is completely in agreement with the theory we draw. Okay, and of course we are not able to we stopped at 2.1. Okay, after that the periods grow bigger and bigger when you are sure to find stability, and from a computational point of view it's a nightmare. So we stop at some point and say after that we have some analytical result for f close to 2.
The sonic point difficulty you mentioned before, is that also in the small amplitude solution? It should be contained in that.
It's always there. It's always there.
So how do they get rid of it?
We don't need them.
Yeah, how do they get around that? Or they don't do it.
They don't care about that, actually. They just make it's a bifurcation point, and
that's it.
Okay, so of course you get small amplitude solution. Erterich, it's a degenerate of bifurcation because of the fact that you have a singular this singular term in front. You have the small term in front of the second order derivative, so the frequency grows and grows forever, and so you don't see the problem for small amplitude. The problem comes up when you try to build up large amplitude solution. And you have, so you have two zones. You have the slow zone, okay? And you have the fast zone. So the fast zone is nothing but an analysis of a shock, okay? You zoom and you have a shock, a viscous shock. And actually, the end state are the one you get by Rankine Ugonio jump condition. Okay, so there's no problem here. If you analyze the slow part, so the slope, if I draw a picture, so more or less, what you get is, this is the slow part, that gives you the equation of profile for an inviscid problem. You have a sonic point here, okay? And if you look the normal dynamic, it is attractive here and repulsive here, okay? And so the condition, the dynamic is very sensitive to what's going on near the sonic point. And what you prove, actually, that so you have a velocity that depends on epsilon, which is given by C naught plus epsilon C, let's say, solitary wave. Okay, so you have one speed. That gives you, so you have here, so you have a solitary wave here. You are able to build up for one particular value of the bifurcation parameter, that is C, okay? And if you want to get the other one, the periodic one, you have to move C, okay? But to go from one periodic wave to another, you will have to change C by an exponentially small quantity. Okay, so and actually this is absolutely normal. What you find out is that in the unviscid limit, all periodic waves share the same speed. Okay, when epsilon goes to zero, they have all the same speed. The only thing that changes is the wavelength. Okay, so if you want to change the wavelength, you have to change the speed a little bit for the viscous problem, and the change has to be exponentially small if you want to go from one periodic solution to another. Okay. Okay. So the analysis is so this is for the to carry out expansion here and here and here. It's a huge work, and then you have to carry on the same type of computation at the spectral for the spectral problem. Okay, so okay, it's doable, but actually this is a work in progress. Okay, so in a few words, how you build up a spectral stability analysis in the case of discontinuous profile. Okay, so the best way to see that is to come back to shocks. Okay, so if you have a shock, okay, a perturbation of a shock, you won't search for a perturbation of a shock with a shock located exactly at the same place. Okay, this will restrict the space of perturbation. So what you do is that a perturbation of this picture, in fact, is more like this. Okay, the shock is slightly changed. Okay, the position of the shock. So a perturbation of one single shock, okay, you have to make some resynchronization, okay? Just as you do for a unimodal solution in the continuous case, okay? You just make a translation so that the two solutions, the two perturbations, have the same, the shock at the same place, okay? And in the case of an infinite number of shocks, what you do is that you resynchronize all the shocks. Okay, but this is nothing but modulation as we did for continuous. Okay, but here you have a discrete set of position. Okay, but still you can make a change of variable to a modulation to resynchronize all the shocks. So you are doing this. The shocks are ruled by the Rocky-Nugonio jump condition, okay? And since these are perturbations, the Lax conditions are satisfied for the reference solution, so you don't care about the Lax condition for the perturbation anymore. Okay? They are perturbations. Okay, so the only condition that comes up comes from the linearization of the PDEs and the linearization of the Rocky-Nugonio jump condition. Okay, and then you plug the fact that the profile is periodic. Okay, so the structure is like this, and one additional problem in that setting is that this set of differential equations is singular, okay, because of the sonic point. Okay, the Jacobian, the determinant of the matrix in front of the derivatives is zero at the sonic point. Okay, so the set of let's say bounded solution is only one dimensional. Okay? So the eigenvector here is only a one dimensional set for the continuous part. And then you have to check whether it fits with the jump condition, the linear jump condition, and this gives you what is called a Lopatinsky determinant. Okay, for shocks, it's called Lopatinsky determinant. Okay, you have typical evolution of the continuous part, and they have to match with the jump, and this is the same here. Okay, so we did some expansions, and as it is classical for spectral stability result, you are able to compute some index. Okay, so this is nothing but telling that you have some necessary condition of stability, and if they are not met, then you have spectral instability. So we are able to build up an index. That tells you that more or less, if the index is smaller than one, if the index is smaller than one, there are no unstable eigenvalue. And if it is smaller than one, there is a full line of unstable and unbounded eigenvalue. So actually, what it tells you that, okay, if the index is bigger than one, there are no eigenvalue of asymptotically large modulus. Okay, so if it is bigger than one, what you are able to say that there are no unstable eigenvalue here, they are necessarily bounded. Okay, and if the index is smaller than one, actually, you are able to prove that you have a line of unstable eigenvalues of asymptotically large modulus. Okay, and they are close to a line like this. Okay, so you have unstable eigenvalue here and unstable eigenvalue here. But in all cases, what you can prove is that the real part of the eigenvalue is bounded. So, they can be large, but the real part is bounded. Okay? So, what you are able to prove is that, let's say, as a corollary of this this picture, is that shallow water equations are well posed near a roll wave. Okay? You can take a small perturbation of a roll wave. In the sense I made it here, and shallow water equations are well posed. Okay, so this is a very weak stability result. Okay, you say that for some finite time, you don't break the structure. Okay, so it's very weak, but it's quite adapted to the hyperbolic nature of equation. You know, for hyperbolic equation, that some shocks may appear, and they may appear even in the continuous part, okay? Okay, let me skip those parts. so what we get from numerics is that, again, we find a range of stably spectral roll wave for the discontinuous case, and the job will be to get the same picture for the viscosity goes to zero, and to show that actually the spectrum in the viscous case is given by the spectrum in the inviscid case when the viscosity goes to zero. Okay, this is the last slide. So the perspective, as I said, the spectral stability in the vanishing viscosity limit. So this relies more on singular perturbation theory. And so we have more or less a complete theory for parabolic equation and when we have spectral stability. So now the questions that pop up in some sense, and what's going on out of this region of stability? Okay, and we expect two scenarios. At the lower bound, where the more or less generically the Wittam system is not hyperbolic, we expect some coalescence dynamic. Okay, and for the upper bound, the system, the Wittam system is hyperbolic, but you have a loss of dissipativity. So maybe it would be interesting to compute higher order terms and see if we cannot find some stabilizing effect. In any case, we would find some new dynamic in this region. So that would be very nice to tackle. And in all my discussion, I did not to care about the influence of surface tension. So again, it would be interesting to consider this question, especially when you look at the bifurcation in the KdV KS diagram. So in the KdV KS diagram, when let's say epsilon goes to zero and delta goes to one, so you increase the weight of the Kuramoto-Sivashinsky term, and this is the place where you have surface tension. Okay, and this would be interesting to track exactly the bifurcation in the stability diagram. And what is not possible to do up to now is having the same type of theory for a conservative system. When you don't have any dissipation anymore. So this is typically the case for dispersive equations, or KdV or whatever. You don't have dissipation, you have dispersion. And to build up a theory of stability in this case, of nonlinear stability in this case, is much more involved. Of course, you have many, many results when you consider coperiodic solution. So you have the result by Chatham-Strauss plus many new results that came up the last 13 years, but they are dedicated to coperiodic perturbation. Or maybe you can add doubly periodic perturbation, but that's it. Okay, and when you increase the number of periods, the problem gets more and more involved. Okay, so of course there are many results on stability, but for coperiodic in the dispersive setting, and it would be very interesting to tackle what's going on in that setting. And I'm done. Thank you very much for attention. Thank you, bye. Should I do something more?
I'll just switch it off.
Just shut down. Ah, yeah.